He did announce that he was God.
Father, we thank you for Brother Joseph and Jane and David and the new one on the way. Yeah. Father, we just ask that you would touch Joseph today and his words, Lord, that they would speak to us and he would speak through you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. I thought today we would be outside and it rained, but that's okay. How are you doing today? Good, good. Nice to see you. Thank you very much for coming. Say hi to the church. You just say hi. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for coming, and you're always welcome to Denton Community Church. You know, I was prepared for an outside service, so that's why that was fine. I really wanted to go out there. That would be nice, but it's not okay that we are here. It's good to see you. Today we're supposed to finish our series on the Lord's Prayer about yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. And I know some of your Bibles do not contain that, you know. And so we will handle that next week because we'll be outside. Let me prepare something new. So I prepared something new, and I hope this is going to have an impact to each one of us. I want to start by a question. Do we fall into sin or do we walk into sin? Because I have had people say that, you know, I fell into sin. And my question is, do we walk into it, like it's a step-by-step, something that we think about and we go to it? Or is it something that, my, I just fell into this, I just found myself in this situation? Church, what do you think? Are you sure? And why is it sometimes when we mess up, or you have even had friends who say that, you know, I just fell into this. You know, I just found myself into this. But I agree with you. I think it's just something that we walk into. Let me just give you some examples. Adam and Eve, the earliest example that we have in Genesis chapter 3. You know, the temptation, we read that in Genesis 3, and it was just a step by step. Let me show you. Just go to Genesis 3. Today we are going to open scriptures a lot, so be prepared for that, because this is nice. It's nice to just open. I'm sorry we don't have PowerPoint today, that's because we are supposed to be outside. You know that. Genesis chapter 3, verses 2. So the woman answers the serpent. Genesis 3, verses 2 says this. That, you know, the Lord said, this is what the Lord said, that we may eat from fruit from the tree in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. You see, what Eve is doing, that this is what the Lord said, and Eve even goes to an extent of adding something that the Lord did not command. Did you notice that? She went to a person saying that the Lord said that you should not even touch it. Did the Lord command that? Okay, let me go through you. Check Genesis 2 verses 17. 2 verses 17. Just there. 2 verses 17. This is what the Lord said. But you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat of it, you will surely die. There was no addition of touch. That was her make. You see, so she's in this conversation, walking into it, and Satan says, no, no, the Lord, you will not surely die. And finally, in verses 6, see this in Genesis 3:6, when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, sin, pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some of it, and she gave some to her husband, who was with him, and he ate it. See, it is pleasing just step by step. Another example that comes in my mind right now is that of David. David with Bathsheba. The Bible starts in 2 Samuel chapter 2 Samuel chapter 11 talks about that in the scene with Bathsheba. And you know what he did? You know, he was supposed to be in war. But he said he's God. He said he's God. You just go and take care of that. I'll be here in Jerusalem, left him just relaxing. Something that was not meant to be. The king was supposed to read the war. And so it is in that he started working. Seeing the woman, sends for her. No, you know, the first thing was to inquire. Just inquire, who is that lady? And when he was told who she is, then he said, go and bring her to me. It is a walk by walk thing. Precious people, are there dangers of walking into sin just like that? Are there dangers of that? Church? Yeah. And today I want us to just focus into that and just focus into the dangers and let us see the remedy for that. Because sometimes we have friends who are into that, or even us, we are sometimes going through that and just feel like we need to talk this. So the text for today is in 2 Kings chapter 14. That's the text that we are going to handle today. We haven't really talked about the Old Testament, so I thought this would be just a good break from what we have been going on. 2 Kings chapter 14. Let me lay the context here. We read from verse 7, but let me lay the context here. It's about Amaziah, the king of Judah. So here we're talking about kings. We talk about the other one, Josh. But King Amaziah, the king of Judah, the two tribes that were left Judah after the all tribes broke up. So there was the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. So it's about the southern kingdom of Amaziah, who was the king. Who was the king? And this king, he started learning. He became a king when he was 25 years old, because by then it was a bit of inheritance. So when your dad died, the son took over. So this guy was 25 years old, and the Bible record says that he reigned for 29 years. That's what he did. Verses 3 of 2 Kings 14 talks about that he did good, but he never followed the Lord wholeheartedly, like the way his dad or like the way his forefathers David did. So he was good, you know, tried to do good things, but he never followed the Lord wholeheartedly. Because one of the things that he did when he became a king, he never abolished the worship of idols. Verse 3 talks about that. He never abolished that. So he allowed the worship of idols to continue in Jerusalem, to continue in Judah. He never, and so that's why somebody said that he never followed the Lord wholeheartedly. Now in verse 7, we come to verse 7 and says this. He was talking about Amaziah. He was the one who defeated 10,000 Edomites in the Valley of Salt and captured Sarah in a battle, calling it Jacobo, the name it is to this day. So here he is. He is the king. He's young. He's successful. He's out there battling the Edomites. The Edomites were enemies of the Israelites, were enemies of Judah. And he captured, he kills 10,000. You read that in another, in Second Chronicles, also talking about this. You read that in Second Chronicles, and you see how he defeated those enemies, the Edomites. He captured them, and then he captured these 10,000. And you know what he did? He took them on the top of a cliff. So these enemies took them on the top of a cliff and started, you know, throwing them down from a cliff, killing them. So the guy was successful. He is defeating the enemies. Young, successful, and he thinks he owns all. And what does he do? Verses 8. Then Amaziah, so this guy who is defeating all the enemies, then Amaziah sent messenger to Jehoash, son of Jehoahaz, the son of Jehu, the king of Israel. So where he brought from Israel, with the challenge, come meet me face to face. So when you see that word, come meet me face to face, you think of a demon, you know? You think that, come meet me face to face, come we eat, you know, we enjoy our time. I don't think so. He's not asking for for a fellowship or time to eat. He's come for war. Come, I'm ready to work on you guys. You are still our enemies. You bought from us. You know, you don't follow the Lord. So come, we meet face to face. Come, we fight. That's He's asking for change. Come, I'm go, I want to fight you because, you know, we still want Israel to be part of us. And so he's asking for challenge. But, verse 9, but Jehoash, king of Israel, replied to Amaziah, king of Judah. Avisto in Lebanon sent a message to a cedar in Lebanon. Give your daughter to my son in marriage. Then a wild beast in Lebanon came along and trampled the Avisto underfoot. You have indeed defeated Edom, and now you are arrogant, glory in your victory. But stay at home. Why ask for trouble and cause your own downfall and that of Judah also? So he sends this message, you know, come for a challenge, you know, I'm ready for you. But Jehoash tells him, no. There is no way you guys, just you two tribes, can defeat us. There is no way you guys can beat us. Why are you asking for trouble? Why don't you stay at home and just focus on your agenda? Don't ask for a challenge. You see something here? Pride is just consuming a Messiah, thinking, and he is a step by step, he's walking into it, and he is warning, the king of Jehoash is warning you, don't try this. This will not go on okay with you. Just don't try this. Don't try me. But the king will not hear of this. Verses 11, Amaziah, however, will not reason to Jehoash, king of Israel. King of Israel attack. He and Amaziah, king of Judah, faced each other at Beth Shan in Judah. Judah was looted by Israel, and every man fled to his home. Verse 13, Jehoash, king of Israel, captured Amaziah, king of Judah, the son of Jehoash, the son of Amaziah at Beth Shemesh. And Jehoash went to Jerusalem and broke down the walls of Jerusalem from the Ephraim gate to the corner gate, a section about 600 feet long. He took all the gold and silver and all the articles found in the temple of the Lord and in the treasures of the royal palace. He also took hostage and returned to Samaria. Step by step, Amaziah is walking into this danger. He's walking because of his pride, this sin of pride consuming him, and he walks into danger step by step. I want us to think through these four things here, these four dangers of walking into sin that we see in this verse. Four dangers of walking into sin. And number one, the one that we see there, is that there was disgrace into the nation. One danger of walking into sin is that it brings disgrace to the nation. You see that in verses 12. So here he challenges, he tells him, come. And so the king of Israel, Jehoash, says, okay, you want to fight? I'm ready for you. So they want to go there. Verses 12 says that Judah was rooted by Israel and every man fled to his home. That's disgrace. This is the guy who was asking for a challenge. This is the guy who was saying, I'm going to fight you. I'm going to win you. Now see what has happened. They have gone to fight, and this guy has been disgraced. The Bible says that they all fled to their home. The guy is the one who asked for the challenge, and now see what's happening to him. Disgrace falls to him as a person and to the whole nation. You see, precious people, this is the problem with sin. Is that it brings disgrace to the person and to the friends and to the community. It was just Amaziah's decision to want to go for war, and he took his troop to war. But when they were attacked, it's all the people in Judah who were affected by that. That's the problem with sin. You make a mistake, you sin something, you do something against the Lord, and what I would do, it brings disgrace to you as a person, to me as a person. person, but also to the community, to the church, to the people who love you, and to the people who care for you. That's what I see here. It brought disgrace. Amaziah was just defeated. And what that did bring, it brought disgrace to him and to his family. The second thing that I see here in verses 13, is that it decreased their defenses. Verses 13. It decreased their defenses. Verses 13 says this. Jehoash, king of Israel, captured Amaziah, king of Judah, the son of Jehoash, the son of Amaziah at Beth Shemesh. Then Jehoash went to Jerusalem and blew down the walls of Jerusalem from Ephraim Gate to the corner gate, a section about 600 feet long. It decreased their defenses. Now, something you need to know about Jerusalem and the way they lived during those times. The walls were very important. The walls, right, you know, in this city, those were things for security. That's what they used to protect themselves from. So that was a big thing, because the way they built the walls, they were so big, and on top of the walls, they would have like soldiers, you know, on top of these walls who are like manning the whole city. So to break a wall, to affect a wall, that was a big thing. You affect the, you know, taking a wall out. Abolishing the wall, that's just a big thing. To illustrate this, you know the story about Nehemiah, the story in Nehemiah, where Nehemiah wants to go back to Jerusalem and rebuild the wall because the whole city was in disgrace. That's how important the walls were. And now here we are, this king Jehoash comes now to the city, and what does he do? He brings down the wall about 600 feet. He decreased the defense of the Judah, of Amaziah, and the whole of Jerusalem. You see, there's something another sin does, brothers and sisters. It decreases our defense to say no to sin again. When we give in to something, when we give in to sin, when we give in to something that we know it's against God's will, it reduces our power to say no next time. It decreases our sensitivity to say no next time. Let me illustrate this by a story I heard about. If you take a frog, and I'm not telling you to, don't try this at home. You need to. Don't try this at home. You can try it in a lab, but not at home. Now, if you take a frog and throw it in a hot water, boiling hot water, what will it do? Good. It will jump. This is too much for me. This is too much for me. It will just jump and off it goes. But take the same frog and throw it in a cold water, you know, warm room temperature. This is really nice. But just start warming that water, you know, take that water of the frog in and start warming that water, warm. What will the frog die? What will the frog do? I gave you the answer, sorry. You got me. The frog will just die. Because, you know, the world is just increasing temperature, but the sensitivity, you know, this is okay, you know, it's just adopting. If you want, you can go and try that, not a problem. It will die because the water is boiling, but its sensitivity is gone, you know, it's like, this is okay. It's like trying to adapt to this environment, and finally, it will die. You see, that's what sin does. It breaks our defense to be able to say no next time. One guy by the name John Bridge said this. This is a quote from him. He said this: every time we say yes to temptation, we make it harder to say no the next time. And how true is that? Every time we say yes to temptation, we make it harder to say no next time. You see, that's what we see in this. Amaziah went into this. He asked for it. What did it happen? All the while, his defenses were all broken. His defense for the future, for the protection of the future, was all taken down. That's one danger of walking into sin. It decreases our sensitivity to say no to sin. Next time. The third thing that I see in this is in verses 14. The third thing is that it diminished their worship. It diminished their worship. Verses 14 says this. He took, now Joash, this king who has now attacked Amaziah, he took all the gold and silver and all the articles found in the temple of the Lord and in the treasures of the royal place. Here he comes, he is now in the city. He has broken all the defenses. And now he came to the high priest. He came to the palace. He came to the articles found in the temple. He even came to the temple. Went to the temple and took all of the precious things, the precious gift. He took all of them and went with him. He took all the treasures, the important things, and he went with them. Something that he is doing here, he is affecting their worship. Their worship for the Lord is attempted, is affected. You see something, precious people, with sin is that when we sin, we can come to the Lord and ask for forgiveness. That one we can. And he promises to forgive us. But you know what? Just as sin is forgivable, the treasure that is taken away, it's taken away permanently, never to come back again. When the treasure, that ability to say no, that treasure that's gone is taken away, whether it is health, whether it is holiness, whether it's innocence, whether it's honesty, whether it's trust, you know, that is taken away to never come back again. And that's what I see here. That was taken away. All these treasures were all taken away to never come back. The worship of the Israelites were affected at this time. All the things that they were using to worship the Lord, they were all taken away. This is the problem. It diminishes their worship. And the guy was warned even from the beginning that he should not try this. The final thing that I see that it destroyed their freedom, verses 14b. Verses 14b. He also took hostages and returned to Samaria. There you go. He took some of them. By the way, even the king Amaziah was taken hostage. He took some of them as slaves and he returned to his capital, Samaria. He took away their freedom. Precious people, you and I know that's what sin does. It takes away our freedom. That was taken away from them. Their freedom in who they was. Some of them were taken as captives to that. Somebody said this. The chains of sin are too light to be felt until they are too strong to be broken. You can illustrate that by taking a string, you know. You take a string and tie somebody, you know. You tie two, you know, like two strings to a person and tell that person to break them. Two cords, somebody might be able to break them and like say, he's a superman, you know, he's able to do that. But take the same string and tie it probably 50 or 100 times. You know, you tie a person 50 or 100 times and tell the same person to break those. They become hard to break. You see, the chains of sin are too light to be felt until they are too strong to be broken. That's what sin does. It makes us captive. Our freedom goes to say no to what we know it's right. Benjamin Franklin, he was not a believer, but he was a wise guy. He said this, sin is not hurtful because it is forbidden, but it is forbidden because it is hurtful. I like those kinds of praying with words there. You see, sin is not hurtful because it's forbidden, but it is forbidden because it is hurtful. And one thing that it does, it breaks away, it prevents, it affects our freedom. Now, that's what Amaziah, he walked into this, to this. He walked, his pride, his sin of pride allowed him to walk into this, affecting his freedom, diminishing his worship, affecting all this. And that's the result that we see there. And I know probably some of you are asking, yes, I hear you. I hear there are dangers. And I know probably you even knew before that there are dangers of walking into sin. But what is the remedy? What is the solution for this? I want to just finish with this verse. In Proverbs 28, verses 13. The remedy. Because, yes, when we walk into sin, our defenses will be broken. That's for sure. When we walk into sin, our worship, by the way, if you just know where you are spiritually, look at your worship lifestyle. That's like a good thermometer to tell you where you are. It's just like, just a good thing. When we walk into sin, our worship is diminished. So, what is the remedy for this? Verses 13, Proverbs 28, verses 13 says this. He who conceals his sins does not prosper. But whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy. The person who conceals his sin keeps on, like, this is not a big thing. I'm fine with this. I can do away. I'm okay. The person who covers those things, that person does not prosper. But the contrast, but the person who confesses, who agrees with the Lord, that Lord, this is sin, and I cannot go on into this. I agree with you. This is not right. This is that person who confesses them. And then, not only confessing, but renounces them. To renounce is, I think it's the same word with repentance. To repent is that if you have gone to this direction, that you have been living to this, you take an about turn. You say, yes, I have been doing that, but now I'm taking about turn, and I'm going to live in holiness, in righteousness. You take that on to renounce, to say, yes, I have been doing that, but no again, I'm not going to do that again. I'm coming to you, Lord, for power, for ability to say no to this. That person who does that, the Bible says, that person finds mercy. Precious people, we can always turn to the Lord for the forgiveness of sin and for the hearing of the things that we have done against God's will. That's not conceal. The Bible says that a person who conceals, that person will not prosper. My prayer for you and for me today, in whatever problem, it's pride, probably it's thoughts, it's the way of life, it's the vision that we know that this is not okay. This is against God's will. Whatever you might be going through, and you know you agree with the Lord, that you need to confess. Yes, come to me in prayer. Come to me. Just agree with me. To confess, agree with me. That this is wrong. This is not right. And then start walking in the newness, in holiness, in God's. That person finds mercy. May the Lord help you and me today, brothers and sisters. As we face life, temptation will come. We talked about that a few weeks ago. But my prayer is that we not give in into that. We will not conceal. Whatever we might be going, we are not going to conceal our sin, but we are going to confess them and renounce them, and the Lord promises that we are going to find mercy. And may each one of us receive mercy in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we give you praise. We give you honors for this day. Our prayer is that we not be like Amaziah, this king who was warned not to walk into sin, not to walk in the way of looking for war, not to murder with sin, but he did. And we saw his downfall. Our prayer, Lord, is that you will help each one of us in whatever thing that we might be going through, Lord, to confess our sin and more so to renounce them. And we give you praise because you promise the person finds mercy. And our prayer is that, Lord, we find mercy in you. Help us to do the premise, to confess and to renounce them. And I pray for each one of us here, Lord, that you help us to take time today to just confess, to just renounce. And give us power to break those cords, Lord, those things that might be tearing us and putting us down. Because we want to walk in holiness, in righteousness, in honor of you this week, this month, this year, the coming days, Lord. We want to live for you in this generation. We give you praise, we give you honor, and once again, thank you so much for this day. We give you praise and we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a blessed week.